before you a very detailed land board scenario, asking basically for legal cancellation of GL 4191, which is a lease for the science research. Neutral cancels and then a reissuance of the next 5 year lease. Secondly, the neutral cancellation of GL 5529, which is the information center area, and a reissuance of the new 65 year lease. And the third item being asked is for the extension, amendment, and restatement of existing access. First off, I'd like to thank the new staff together with their lawyers, as well as Deputy Attorney General Julie Chino, who assisted Kevin Moore from my office working on this scenario and the various amendments that are before you. To start off, my general understanding of what we have before you is I think the first thing I should address is that this, what is before you is the leases and leases, which is a land disposition. And there are basically changes that DH is being asking this board to approve. And the focus of these changes is, and DH is here and the council can explain it further, but is to, from what I understand, is to make it consistent and conform to the comprehensive management plan approved by this board in 2009. Separate that and distinguish that from what was before the board on the conservation district's permit from what I understand it's for the construction or authorization to construct the 30-meter telescope. That is a separate conservation district's permit. I understand that is there was a request for contested case, which was denied the request for contested case, and I understand that matter. Granted the
conservation
use permit,
but
the case for the 30-meter telescope. And that matter is up on on the management plan back, which was approved in 2009, my understanding is there was also a request for contested case, which was denied by the board, and it went up on appeal, and the board's decision was affirmed, as I understand. And so the changes here today is UH's, is necessary to perform the leases to comprehensive management plan approved in 2009. As I mentioned, there is inside the submittal and attached as exhibits various standard form provisions, which UH and their lawyers, together with our staff and our lawyers, worked on, and we are recommending these amendments to the board. UH is here together with their lawyers and some community members, and I understand there's an
several members of the UH management team for the Mauna Kea management areas. Interim President Lasner was called away a short while ago and asked me to let you know that he individually and as president is committed to the responsible stewardship of the UH management areas on Mauna Kea through the plans and community-based consultative process put in place over the past decade. And I think in a very nice, concise way, that summarizes why UH is here today and why we are proposing the changes we've made. The lease before you incorporates the conditions and the language, the requirements and the obligations on the university included in UH's master plan established in the year 2000, in the conservation disputes, the comprehensive management plan that was just referenced. It also includes the mechanisms that are necessary for us to honor our obligations under Act 132. Relating to funds derived from Mauna Kea. And fundamentally, it also provides a basis for us to negotiate and renegotiate leases for subleases for observatories on the mountain. UH takes its responsibility as a steward for these lands with utmost seriousness, and we approach the department to the obligations that the university has accepted into the lease to make clear to all users of the mountain under what terms we're working. And I'd be happy to answer any questions. Any questions for you? Yes,
could you characterize for me in rough terms the annual income from subleases of facilities on the mountain? Say the sublease rents.
The sublease rents are currently at $1 a year.
For all users?
Simple.
Currently. Under the existing lease, under the proposed lease, the leases for new subleases will require substantial lease rents, which under Act 132 must be put in a special account for UH to manage Mauna Kea lands with.
Has that account already been established?
Yes, the account's been established.
Those subleases are going through the same term as the existing lease?
Yes, although I'll refer to lawyers for details.
Existing subleases will be good through the year 2033, unless they are renegotiated before that. Any new sublease would come back.
And I'd simply reiterate that the language in this new lease would provide us the basis for renegotiating services. Special Mauna Kea Management Fund at UH, whose uses are restricted, but it provides support and management and improvements on Mauna Kea land managed by the UH.
And some of those funds were OHA?
Yes. That's 20%.
So $600,000 this year. $200,000 a year for OHA. $800,000 go to this fund.
Right.
Does any of that $800,000 make its way to the Department of Land Management?
They make it to UH to provide the services and necessary things that are needed for the areas that we manage and enough.
Can you characterize the current nature of that fund and maybe some of the expenditures and projects that have been activated?
Let me ask Stephanie Nagata, the director of the Office of Mauna Kea Management, to answer that session.
Currently, the only fees that are being collected by the university are from commercial tour operators, and there are 8 permitted tour operators, and right now we collect about $400,000 annually, of which we have paid OHA in full for all of the monies due to them for the past years up to 2007. So those monies are used for management purposes for the road maintenance, snow removal, maintenance, and operations of the visitor information station, which is the key to the public.
And any of it going to, say, environmental protection or remediation?
We use it whenever we have instances for environmental protection review, like that.
Invasive species.
Okay, right now, what we're applying those funds are for impacts and that are directly caused by the tour operators. But we anticipate if there is any new sublease that's been negotiated, those monies would be used towards programs, management programs.
How many subleases do you have right now?
We have subleases with
30?
No, I believe it's fewer than that because the university is one of the operators of the. I believe there are about 12, maybe 11.
And these include international entities?
Some of them do, yes.
When did these leases come up for renegotiation?
The subleases? The subleases all expire on December 31st, 2033.
Which you are getting a dollar a year.
Currently, when the subleases are negotiated, the term of a dollar a year was a value that was required to make a contract, I guess, sublease legal. And what they did was that they provided viewing to the university to do astronomical research. But the sublessees, what they do is they provide maintenance activities. So they provide the road, they maintain the road for public access, and also the economic, indirect economic impact of the observatories has a substantial impact, especially on the day.
Has the university ever calculated what the value is of that kind of concern?
It's very difficult to evaluate the value of scientific research, but what we do have is the cost of operating the facility.
Can you tell me what the amount of viewing time the university avoids?
Customary practices in the lease area. Now, I'll be speaking on his behalf, but he would like to make a short statement to the board that I'm included. Now, we have submitted written testimony to the board objecting to these proposed lease actions, so I'll do my best to keep testimony brief. And we would also like to add that we are agreeing with and incorporating the objections that have been put forth by the Office of Hawaiian Affairs. The three issues I would like to emphasize is, one, whether the board and the department has fulfilled their duties to independently investigate Native Hawaiian practices and rights under the Ke Kapa'a Kai o Kaina. Second, whether the board and the department will be in violation of Hawaii Revised Statutes 343 by exempting these leases from a preparation of an environmental assessment. And the third is whether the board and the department will be in violation of their high fiduciary duties to manage seed and land. Very briefly, as a threshold issue, I think it is very clear, especially by the staff seminars that were put forth, that the board and the department have not yet fulfilled their duty under Kapa'a Kai. Kapa'a Kai says that when an agency makes a decision, they must do three things. One, identify cultural, historical, natural resources. Two, determine the extent to which those resources and the Native Hawaiian practices that depend on them will be affected. And three, to take any action necessary to protect Native Hawaiian rights. Now, this is the key. The Supreme Court was very clear. This analysis must be independent. It cannot be placed upon the applicant. Now, in Kapa'a Kai specifically, the court said the Land Use Commission could not rely upon a management plan prepared by the applicant to satisfy their duties to investigate and protect Native Hawaiian rights. Now, unfortunately, here we have exactly what the Supreme Court said you cannot do. And we see this in the staff submittal. The Kapa'a Kai analysis under the staff submittal says that we are not to use the studies and investigations done in the university's 2009 comprehensive management plan. And obviously, the university here is an applicant. So therefore, the studies done in the management plan were not an independent investigation. And I think this can be especially highlighted by the fact that we've heard that the university attorneys assisted with the staff submittal, which included this proposed Kapa'a Kai analysis. Okay. So I think it's clear, before any action can be had, the board and department needs to do their own Kapa'a Kai analysis. They cannot rely upon the management plan, which is what is being done here, and is what the Supreme Court prohibited in the Kapa'a Kai case. Now, second, I'd like to briefly address the issue of whether an environmental assessment should be prepared. The staff submittal proposes to exempt these leases from the preparation of an EA. However, this type of action is not entitled to an exemption by law. HEPA is very clear. An environmental assessment must be prepared for any action that proposes the use of state or county lands. It is true, some actions can be exempted. The Supreme Court has told us in Kahana Sunset that this is only for very minor projects. And the staff submittal explains this away, saying, well, the board should commonly use this as a practice of exempting leases generally. However, leases cannot be generally exempted from the preparation of an environmental assessment. See, when you look at Hawaii Administrative Rules 11-200, that chapter defines the use of state lands as any lease, permit, easement, license, etc. Therefore, a lease cannot be considered exempt if the definition of a use of land includes the term lease. Second, even if leases could be generally exempt, sensitive areas are not eligible for exemptions from the preparation of an environmental assessment. It can't be disputed here that this lease area is very sensitive. The university itself and their CMP says Mauna Kea is probably one of the most significant cultural and astronomical sites in the world. And they also admit in many places that the Mauna Kea Science Reserve contains both culturally and environmentally sensitive areas. And I've put forth some of these areas in our written testimony. Now, the university recognizes it is clear that to many Hawaiians, Mauna Kea is more than a mountain. It is the embodiment of the Hawaiian people. And this area is also very sensitive and important to Mr. Flores. He has previously been qualified as an expert to cultural practices related to Mauna Kea and the area of Hawaiian cultural traditions through his knowledge, skill, and experience. And finally, as to this 343 issue, federal case law says that a renewal of a project or an action must be considered as if it was brand new, not a continued use. So the university cannot say, well, if this is just, you know, yes, it's a lease, but we've had this lease for 45 years. No, under federal case law, you must act as if this was a brand new lease. So for those reasons, these proposed lease actions do not fit into one of the specified exemptions. And finally, I just wanted to make a brief comment on implications of the Ceded Lands Trust, and I'll defer to the Office of Hawaiian Affairs and other testifiers to expand on this issue. But it's clear from the staff submittal, these are ceded trust lands. And they must be held by the state of Hawaii as public trust for Native Hawaiians and the general public. Now, UH has pointed out that, well, in their view, the lease allows them to extract more revenue or more lease rent from their subleases. But if we look at the actual lease terms, we see a couple things. One, they are paying nothing to the Board of Land and Natural Resources. That would be in violation of their trust, of the state's trust duties, to be impartial among all beneficiaries. You see, you cannot allow education to trump the interests of the public and Native Hawaiians. They must be both treated together in their best interest. And not charging any lease rent, while that may benefit the university, it does not benefit Native Hawaiians, who would receive 20% of those funds from OHA. Second, even if the lease does allow the university to charge an increased amount of lease rent for their subleases, there is nothing in the lease terms that require them to do so, nor does it require fair market value. And of course, we have this question on how do you value telescope time. Well, I think it would be simple. There needs to be accounting. How much has this telescope time been rented for on the open market? For these and other reasons, on behalf of Mr. Flores, we would like to request a contested case hearing, and briefly, I'd like to, if you would so allow, have Mr. Flores make a brief personal statement.
I'm advised not to speak too much on the legal aspects, but I just want to ask some pointing questions. The subleases, my understanding, are co-terminus with the general lease. If the general lease ends, which is being requested, then so do the subleases end. Wouldn't it be appropriate then to revisit and renegotiate the subleases and instead allowing them to continue to 2033? What's wrong with that picture? If the lease, the existing lease ends, so does the subleases. Then it's subjected to paying fair market value rent for these new subleases. Not waiting to 2033, but now. Secondly, they're also confined to the rules and regulations of the decommissioning plan. If you look at the decommissioning plan, which you folks approved, there are certain regulations when a new lease comes into existence, sublease, there are certain requirements for that. That is not being addressed in this proposed new leases. And with that aside, there's the Mauna Kea, the mountain of Sky Father. The mountain is a sacred people to all of us. And that's not Kanaka, but to all of us. It's a sacred people. And for 45 years, it's been allowed to be desecrated and destroyed. How did that occur? With the existing lease of 40 that's in existence in 1968, that is allowed to occur. How did it allow to occur to become substantial, adverse, and significant impacts? How did it happen? 45 years. Nobody can explain it. Every board action that has taken place since then to up until this time has allowed that to happen. And in the record, and they want to declare that it's not going to be this new proposed lease, it's going to be a minimal impact. No, 45 years have already shown what has happened. So I'm saying, Iale na piko o Kealoha o Keapua, we just must be awakened to what's happening at this moment. What is truth and what is untruth? Mauna Wakea is a sacred piko. And it's a sacred piko, please treat it as such. And from the Mauna to here, we just bring our aloha from Hoko Kiawe, from Mauna Awakea to to all of you who sit in a position to make an important decision for our people. Mahalo for this time. Aloha no.
My name is Kale Gumapac, and I represent the Karakua Council, Moanikeala, on the island of Hawaii. And this is Dexter Kaiama, our attorney that represents us, and Nanci Munroe, who is also a member of the Karakua Council, Moanikeala. I submitted written testimony to the board, as well as Nanci Munroe, and so I'm going to deviate from my testimony slightly. It's important that we lay the foundation of information to the board in regards to the mutual cancellation of the general lease for UHFM Mauna Kea. And in the foundation that we're going to lay, it's important that we provide information of correct terminology, because I am a Hawaiian Kingdom subject and I am finally learning my political genealogy as to what happened. There was never a treaty of annexation, and so now we need to correct some terminology. First off, ceded lands. Ceded lands continues to perpetuate the lie of what actually took place. Because when we take a look at what sessions is, when you look at sessions, it means that you have a country that legally transferred itself over to another country. There has to be a treaty of annexation that took place. So what happened to the Hawaiian Kingdom? Was there a treaty of annexation that took place that legally transferred itself over to the United States? That never happened. There were two attempts that were made in 1893 and the second attempt in 1897. Both attempts failed. Then in 1898, the United States Congress passed a resolution that said we are going to take the Hawaiian Kingdom. It was a congressional resolution taking the Hawaiian Kingdom, and that is not a treaty of annexation. That law can only apply within the territorial limitations of the United States. They cannot apply in a foreign country of the Hawaiian Kingdom. From that point on, the lie took place from 1898 forward. There was never a treaty of annexation here in Hawaii. The cover-up took place all the way up to today, 2013. And when I hear people say that ceded lands, especially when the Office of Hawaiian Office of Hawaiian Despair talks about it, it's very, very discouraging, because they themselves should be the ones to know. And when you have the governor talk about ceded lands, he should know, because it never happened. These are Crown lands, and you, as board members, should be referring properly to these lands. So the lands up at Mauna Kea should be referred to as Crown lands, properly. So let's talk about those lands. Because of there's no treaty of annexation, What that means is that the United States has no jurisdiction here in Hawaii. Even the U.S. Pacific Commander and their lawyers admit that there was never, ever a treaty of annexation. There were two executive agreements by Queen Liliuokalani and President Cleveland, of which she assigned her executive position to President Cleveland. President Cleveland accepted it, and he also said that he would restore the Hawaiian Kingdom government. Those executive agreements apply today. So the proxy queen of the Hawaiian Kingdom is Barack Obama. His responsibility is to enforce Hawaiian Kingdom constitutional law, and his responsibility is to restore the Hawaiian Kingdom government, which puts you as board members responsible to enforce Hawaiian Kingdom law when you make determinations into these kinds of leases, if that. You are responsible for that, and you're supposed to be using Hawaiian Kingdom law when you make these determinations. Because if you do not, and you're using U.S. laws, which includes state laws and HRS laws, you can now be charged with a war crime. Because in 1959, when the Statehood Act came along, that was a war crime. We are now laying the foundation to present this information to you, because it is very important that in this foundation, in further decisions from this point on, and I was advised by our attorney, Dexter Kaiama, that in all past decisions, you could not be hit with war crimes. But from this point on, because we are now laying this foundation, you can now be charged with war crimes, because we have now laid the foundation. And you cannot say you did not know. I have provided this information to you. You have now got it on your table. And it is now your responsibility to research it, because we are opposed to the lease that is now before you up in Mauna Kea. Nanci Munroe will further be able to provide more information as to why, under the Geneva Conventions and the United States constitutional law, you guys have got to follow this.
So, can you summarize that? Because you represent all of this.
No, it's short.
Hang on. We're going to, not today, but we're going to hand off to our attorneys, right? We're supposed to represent us. As you said, now that you provide us with the information,
yes,
we have to do the analysis. That's not part of the, it is, but it's not part of the process that we're doing. We have to have them do that.
Actually, just a few words, because I don't want to reiterate what's already been submitted in the written testimony. Of course, the legal position of gentlemen is that, of course, the United States continues its usurpation of illegal occupation. The position, really, Mr. Aila and board members, is that you temporarily are responsible for the management of these land areas. And I say temporarily because I wish to inform you that as of August of 2012, a complaint calling for the end of the prolonged occupation was filed with the United Nations General Assembly. That complaint was received, and acknowledgement of that complaint. Just for your information, those kinds of complaints can only be acknowledged and received if you are a state that recognizes an independent state. In addition, a complaint was filed with the International Court of Justice a month ago. That also has been acknowledged, and the process is moving forward, calling for some preliminary measures, including countries that have acceded to the jurisdiction immediately to stop all further treaties with the United States concerning any territory with Hawaii, to stop any engagement as far as political, social, economic, or military with the United States concerning the territory with Hawaii. The point is, ladies and gentlemen, it has been 120 years since the illegal overthrow and 115 years since the illegal occupation. on those matters are now being addressed in the international community. I believe a resolution to those issues will be forthcoming within the near future. So it is my request, respectfully, and I think listening to some of the questions that the board members did ask today, I do believe you are taking some responsible steps as towards what should be the proper stewardship for Mauna Kea. Presently, though, as proposed, the lease as proposed, it is my estimation, that still falls short. And acceptance of the proposed lease in its current form would, in my estimation, violate your obligations, because your obligations as a temporary one is not only to the state of Hawaii or to the people here in the state of Hawaii, but you do have an obligation to the kingdom of Hawaii. So your stewardship or the decisions that this board makes, which impacts property that properly belongs to the kingdom of Hawaii, Crown and Government lands. Of course, the record itself is being made in this room, so just respectfully ask that you take that into consideration. We would oppose the current lease in its forms.
Also, in addition to that, the countries that do have telescopes up at Mauna Kea, they will be affected by this, as to what is taking place right now currently at the Hague.
Hello, I'm Nanci Munroe, and I'm also with Kanaka Council, Moku Kiawi. And I know I am part of the illegal occupation. I came here to go to the university. I can't say I'm a Hawaiian Kingdom subject, but I want to be in line the first day I can take the oath. And some just legal factual information, the state of Hawaii, nor this board, has legal title to the land on Mauna Kea and has no legal authority to grant a lease. The United States is a high contracting party to the Geneva Conventions and thus is in violation of its own criminal code, which requires that the laws agreed to in the 1949 Geneva Convention IV be written into U.S. constitutional law under U.S. Code Title 18, Section 2441, the War Crimes Act, which directly incorporates several provisions of international treaties governing the laws of war into the U.S. Federal Criminal Code. An armed conflict is not a requisite of application of war crimes when a state, meaning a country, is under military occupation, which Hawaii is. The Kingdom of Hawaii has been under military occupation by the United States of America in violation of neutrality treaties since August 12, 1898, during the Spanish-American War. And according to U.S. Field Manual 27-10, Chapter 6, Item 358, occupation does not transfer sovereignty. Thus, the sovereignty of the Hawaiian Kingdom remains intact. The United States has committed a grave breach of the Geneva Convention 1949 under U.S. Field Manual 27-10, Chapter 10, Item 502, by extensive destruction and appropriation of property not justified by military necessity and carried out unlawfully and wantonly in allowing construction of roads, facilities, and telescopes at Mauna Kea. I am opposed to the proposed mutual cancellation of the general lease and issuance of a new direct lease to UH for the Mauna Kea Science Reserve and Halepuʻako mid-level facilities. The entire existing general lease must be canceled completely to halt any further appropriation of property in violation of both U.S. law and international law. Further decisions made by this board and its members to the lease extension at Mauna Kea will be considered another commission of a war crime and will be reported to the International Criminal Court for investigation and prosecution. Please take care that you are not subject
international arrest when you make your decision. I thank you. I just, in case you have any questions about the lease itself. Yes. And just so you know, I actually did submit memorandum of briefs to special deputies to the Attorney General's office as of last year, so much of this information is already transmitted to the Attorney General's office through the special deputies.
Wait.
Helen, in the current court case, and specifically for Mauna Kea Leases, Clarence Ching, Deborah J. Ward, and Kauila Kopper, who cannot be here today because of traveling and family obligations. I am authorized to speak on their behalf. There are other members here that are also present, so no. Mahalo for this opportunity to testify. Just like to say, because we want to discuss Mauna Kea here, I just want to say that Mauna Kea doesn't belong to the university. It doesn't belong to the state. It doesn't even belong to the Hawaiian people. It belongs to the Akua, not the Mauna. And it's not of this realm. And when we speak of it, it's difficult because it's not of this realm. Because the laws of the heavens dictate what goes on Mauna Kea, not our will, our beliefs, or even our wishes. So I offer up my words. Conservation. Because they're conservation lands, the general provisions governing conservation lands take precedent over and above any other uses. And here, because Mauna Kea is the major purpose of conservation is to protect and conserve the lands under HRS 183C and other statute, that's the first and foremost use. So we have an obligation to make that use. And the beneficiaries of those lands also happen to be the Native Hawaiians and the general public. And so the purpose of those lands are for the betterment of the condition of Native Hawaiians and for the general public. That's above and beyond any sub-use. Astronomy is only a sub-use. And as a sub-use, that is a secondary purpose. That comes after all the other purposes. And I know that sub-use, it was designated sub-use in the 1980s, but it was designated conservation in 1961, and it's never changed. And that's your first and foremost obligation, is to protect those lands in the spirit in which the law was written to do. So that's another major important thing. We are completely against any kind of exemption from environmental review in any way, shape, or form. And you know, the short order reason for that is that Mauna Kea sits over six aquifers that provide all of the drinking water for Hawaiʻi. And just based on that knowledge, we should have environmental review at a minimum. And in fact, all of the environmental review in the past, including the NASA Environmental Impact Statement, the TMT, and DLNR itself, the former chair has admitted all of that the impact is significant, adverse, and substantial to the cultural and natural resources. Not to the astronomy, but to the cultural and natural resources. And that's the reason why Mauna Kea is protected as it is. So we already know, and it's already admitted, that there's negative impact. And so I can just imagine another 65 years. The last point, or second to the last point, is rent. We've been on about this for years. We wrote it to DLNR in our first temple report in 2001 that the rent was due. And the statutes are 171-17 and 18. And it's fair market lease rent. It's not what the university decides they want to pay. It's fair market. And there's a way to assess it. And all you guys need to do is follow that. And in our report, we actually designated money to be given to DLNR. And we allocated all of it. In an ideal world, we thought this is what should happen. And so we might go back to that should be in the I mean, I think that the foreign governments should pay rent because it's the right thing to do. And I think actually many of them would be willing to, but the university holds them hostage. And so if I were you, I would talk to them directly. Because I would agree and concur with what was previously said by Native Hawaiian Newport that it's a requirement. It has to be given and it should benefit the state also. So that's the second part. Comprehensive management plan and also correcting the record. I want to be clear that there's a couple fallacies that keep getting perpetuated in all of the documentation. And the first one is that Act 132 gives them control over UH management areas and astronomy precinct. I will say yes to that, but it does not give them control over the conservation district. That's your folks' jurisdiction. And Act 132 never changed the prevailing laws, land use laws of the state. It didn't change 171, it did not change 183C, nor did it change 205. These are the laws that you may not abide by. These are specific laws. And so while it's true that Act 132 did do some things, including designate that they can charge rent and put it in their own fund that they create, that doesn't mean that you folks don't have to also collect the rent under 171. You folks can, and I think you should, because our state needs it. And I definitely think OHA understands this, and OHA should get some too. And the whole state should get it. So we are opposed to the whole submittal of whatever, D, agenda item D5. I just want to say that for the record. We also want to say that many of the Mauna Kea Lui members are 50% blood, and including Paul Nevis and Kinohi, his son Kinohi. And we do concur with or enjoin OHA's comments, as well as Native Hawaiian Legal Corp at this time. And we, if you proceed ahead, we would like it on the record that we call for a contested case hearing regarding this. And we would call for it in the right spirit of contested case hearing, that all actions stop until the standing is decided of the parties, and that also that the contested case become a venue where we can provide serious discussion to help the DLNR make an informed decision. And with that, I think I finished everything. Oh, why? There's one more correction. The Smithsonian, you asked what the percentage of rent or time in lieu of rent was, and they said 10 to 15%. That's true, but Smithsonian is actually 20%. So I just want to leave that. So, mahalo.
Before you go ahead.
Oh, sorry.
You said that since 2001, you've argued about the fact that a gratis lease rent is unreasonable.
Yeah, right.
I would have thought that maybe you've taken the time to assess what the fair market lease rent value might be.
Okay. At first, to be honest, at first we thought we had a creative idea, and that was, I was a former telescope system specialist, and one of the problems that we had on our telescope was that the University of Astronomers didn't always come out to do observing. So at that time we thought, well, why don't we use the unused time, sell it on the open market for fair market value, and then create a trust. That was our original idea. It was just because pragmatically, IFA couldn't always send their people out, and our telescopes used to sit dormant for a long time. They changed how it was done so that we could use the time for other observing activity. But at that time, that's what we thought. So we were looking at how much is a nightly cost. But unfortunately, even in that report, I think it's not enough, because the nightly costs are only for operating. So I think it needs to be based on how much someone, you know, how much would it be sold on the market? And that was only an estimation. So we came up with something like $50 million when we totaled just...
Sorry, 1.5 million?
Yeah, 50.
50 million.
Yeah, just as a percentage of the total time sold on the market and then put in some kind of fund. And that was adding up all 36 nights, because on average, telescopes get 36 nights they give to the university. And so they actually, the governments, like the British government, has to pay that that operating cost for the university to give them the time. So if they were to do it on the market, they would sell it for these things. But I think in 171, they tell you that some kind of an assessor needs to do it.
And
An appraisal, yeah. Mm-hmm. And I think, so we were kind of corrected by that. But we were trying to come up with a, you know, if no one's going to use the time, hey, sell it and give it back to and the people.
And the follow-up question to that. Follow-up question.
Yeah.
Since you worked at SM, at the time that you worked there, were any of these foreign entities that were selling time to the
Well, how it's done is they've submitted proposals. The proposals get approved. They also submit grants to help pay for those approvals. So it's kind of in their hand. But how much an observatory actually costs to operate, you know, pay all the employees, cost of lighting, you know, electricity, and all of that is the operating. And I mean, Subaru, for example, way back then, operating cost was $300 million. That's a lot. You know, they have to pay for a lot of things. But that isn't, you know, I mean, the state can choose to decide. decide what the rent is too. And so, you know.
It simply wasn't subcontracting.
No, I don't think so. Since the Yale has bought time for $12 million for a certain amount of nights, and I think there's been another one, but honestly, I'm sorry, I can't remember. But, yeah, at least Yale did for that. And that was for 12 nights or something like that. But don't quote me on that. I can't remember off the top of my head.
Approximately.
Yeah.
Yeah. Another, lots of money.
Yeah, yeah.
Further questions? For the record, we lost board member.
How long do we have before we lose our
bar? Another hour.
Mahalo, I'm sorry.
I read and choose to try these candidates, and my perspective comes like this. I'm a farmer, and I've been farming for 30-something years, and in the cost of that coin, we produce more than 100 million pounds of food, yeah? So we kind of know how to do that stuff, and we got to watch out for the cost of money. What happened was 10 years ago, oil prices started going up, and we started to watch our cost for the street. So I went to pick up conferences, and I ended up going to five. And why I went there was to figure out how we're going to position ourselves. I was there to make sure I got the right information. I wasn't there to fool myself. I was trying to figure out. But this is what I found out. The world had been using twice and three times more oil than it actually fine. So we automatically didn't know what the price was. Okay, so time went by, and just recently, so several months ago, Citibank put out a paper. The paper said that Saudi Arabia is going to stop exporting oil by 2030. Just think what that is. 2012, 2030. Short time from now, and 50 months. So what I'm getting at is this. I know the telescopes up there, they're not making really money. If it's just discretionary income and there's a squeeze and it gets really bad, they're not going to come. And what is going to happen to us? The potential for us on that mountain is our future generation. How the next generation look at themselves? Are they going to be folks that are proud of themselves? Are they going to be downtrodden? Are they going to look to education as being a big value? I think that's what is at stake. So really, we have got to move kind of fast because what they say is 2030 is Citibank, and some people are saying 2-3 years. Something in between that time.
Aloha Kako.
Aloha.
Mahalo for the time. I am going to get some fight for them. Wallace Ishibash. Hawaiian. Family come from Kauai, Kupeao. I am from Middle East, South Korea. Much but I come here in support and to allow the UAs to continue managing the market. My biggest concern is that there's a lot of vocal individuals in our community who want to ban astronomy from monitoring. And it sometimes sounds as though they represent the opinions of all or most of the Native Hawaiians. And this is not true. What about the Hawaiians like myself and others that I know support the responsible use of Mauna Kea for astronomy assignment? That's why I chose to express my opinions here today. Misinformation run rampant out in our community. The CMP is in effect. Along with the SAW plans addressing the cultural resources, natural resources, public access, and the decommissioning of the older households. The burial treatment plan, we have our Kahuku Mauna Council, who monitors activities and policies on our own. Invasive species policies and inspections royalties paid to OHA. UH is not perfect, but we strive. Hawaiians use Mauna Kea for various purposes, from the practical to the spiritual, including the study of the night skies, or wind and cloud formations during the day. It is no wonder that today Mauna Kea has established a reputation as being the best location in the world for mankind to conduct it. And this is keeping with the traditional use of the mountain. This brings great honor to Hawaii and offer educational, economic, and career opportunities for our local residents. For example, my cousin, he's just getting ready to retire after serving 30 years working for observatories on Mauna Kea. What an opportunity he had to be able to provide and raise his family by working in the astronomy industry. Why does their voice not come? And there are other many locals who work up there on the summit. Contrary to the opinions expressed by some, this is not an all or nothing, us versus them, or either or option. Science and culture can coexist on the summit. The Mauna Ishibash University is achieving this goal of respectfully accommodating all the people who wish to access the special gifts that Mauna Kea offers. Cultural practitioners can travel to the summit, consulted on management issues, and under the CMP, astronomy facilities must follow strict protocols in order to continue operations on the mountain. What I have seen, that they love and respect the mountain just as much as us and in their own way. All of us who choose to reside on the island of Hawaii make the slopes of Mauna Kea our home. The whole island is sacred. Not only just part of Hawaii, the whole island is sacred. From Hilo to Waikoloa, Kauai to Kohala, development and technology continues. No matter what happens, it will continue. There are many positive outcomes that can come out of the spirit of cooperation. An example is what we're facing now with Lake Waiau. We have some pipes in there stuck in there. The goal is the same. We're trying to remove the pipes in a pono way. Together, and we brainstorm this issue, working for the goal of removing these pipes. You know, this is some of the examples that we're trying to work together with the community and cultural practitioners to best achieve this goal. The best management practices resulted in the removal of the vacant bulk of the endangered species list. Tons of trash that our rangers remove each year, 24/7 protection. It's just some of the reasons why I support the extension and the new lease to the UH. This is the best way to establish a cooperative and positive future. UH will continue to make corrections as we move forward. The UH will continue to be the best man of the mountain. For this reason, allow the UH to Malama, the mountain, fulfill its obligations and commitment to make the astronomy industry viable and a good neighbor.
You mentioned Waiau, and recently I saw some pretty troubling images of the water level in Waiau. Were you there recently, and what's going on there right now with the water level?
It's a low tide.
Really low. Has it ever been that low before?
So probably it's the lowest in the industry, and that's why the pipes now sticking up, and we're concerned with the ISO. And then we're trying to get the historical data on that, why that pipes is there in the first place. Getting a hard time finding a record. It's DLNR, Juliano. We're trying to work and get that ISO. But yeah, some problem. It's part of global warming. We're not having the snow we need to ensure the levels to be maintained. Serious for us. Thank you so much.
First thing I like to dispel, and I brought this up before in a contested case when we're dealing with, okay. First of all, the Mauna Kea, a starting crusade is not in the Aupua Kauai Hamakua. Kaoni is a delineal mark. There are six of them to that. They give you a delineal space, as I spoke earlier. That I'm a religious practitioner being trained, more or less being trained by someone. And so this Kauai is a lineal divides the area known as the Kuiʻis for that of the Akua. And this has been brought to attention before, not necessarily received correctly before, but I bring it to your attention again. And so we need to dispel some of these factors that mislead. There is no way that any Aupua control the summit of the mountain because of its religious significance to all the people. That's why it's Kauai is a delineation marker for that distance between the Kuiʻis and Akua. That being said, there's another part that I need to help dispel also. This is not the state of Hawaii's land. The state of Hawaii is a trustee for the State of Lands Trust, as described under the Admissions Act, Section 5F. Okay, now, because of time and because, we all have to be able to speak, I'm going to try not to duplicate a lot of things, but I concur with most of what was said. Regarding the direct action that we're speaking about now that is on your table, which is the extension of the lease, the mutual discharge of the current lease, which ends in 2033, to extend it up to another 65 years. I believe it was up to 80 years, something like that. I can't do the math right off the top. So one of the things I wanted to be able to say here is that because their lease does not end until 2033, there is absolutely no need for this fast track. Unless, of course, we're talking about providing the incentive or the fauna for the 30-millimeter telescope, which is, again, this is very troubling because this is 5F lands. This is ceded lands. In the current reality that we're living in, it is considered a ceded land, and there are very specific uses for those funds, for that land, for the protection. And so, the subleasing out to private entities or multinational or other countries is not consistent with the land use as described under the 5F Laws of the Admissions Act. That being said, it befuddles me that this information having to do with this hearing was only a week ago. I don't know how I keep falling out of these loops, but I keep getting knocked off all these mailing lists and information lists. I've been on, talking about this for quite a long time now. As you may know or may not know, my father used to work for the DLNR. In fact, he used to work at Kauila, which is now referred to as Mauna Kea State Park. We were the ones who raised the mouflon sheep, as well as the nene. I was taking over the Laualani. We also made all the hunters' cabins going around the mountain. I believe there's six, starting from Pulama or the Pumaili. I can't tell you off the top of my head. I was actually surprised myself that I actually remembered the actual names for each one of them. But my father was the one who drove the bulldozers, who made those houses. Half my childhood was spent making those houses. And working out of Kauila, which is now the Mauna Kea State Park, but in the back is where the DLNR used to do the stuff. And so I have a very deep connection with Mauna Kea. It seems to escape the reality that this of the religious significance of Mauna Kea. And I bring this to your attention because this is a First Amendment issue also. It is not just a fight of fight after, although you are charged specifically for the protection and proper use of fire guns as described in the fire clause of the admission law. You are also mandated by Article 12, Section 7, as a result of the 1976 Constitutional Convention, to protect and to preserve and to promote the interests of the land people. And again, as I explained to you earlier, I am Hawaiian. I am not the Hawaiian that is described in the Admissions Act regarding Hawaiian homes having a 50% blood funding. And that is a very controversial area, and I can actually give you a whole history of why that is illegal, but that is not directly related to this as we're speaking. So first of all, I would like to say I'm totally against all three phases of this, these three leases. So we've already talked about the summit. There is an obligation that is mandated that you are not necessarily stepping to the plate to actualize and make sure that it is properly taken care of from your fiduciary side. That being said, and I concur with just about every comment that's been made about the sacredness of the loan. But getting on to the issue at hand, the second issue involved is the lease at Kauila. Now this is becoming a very, very, very interesting and controversial thing because, and it was by your folks' own probably mistake of releasing this information to me, but that is also the critical habitat. This is under the Environment of the Endangered Species Act. It is critical habitat, and although forestry and wildlife has a certain say in this, if they are not able to complete their fiduciary responsibilities to protect the endangered critical habitat, then it would have to go to a further case. And Bill, you and I both know that I've been very consistent about this. Even dealing with the HAMP program, with the military, and talking about the critical habitat. And so, in fair play, it would be very improper for you to say that we cannot have sheep and that you can do arrow shooting of the sheep in a critical habitat, and then tell me that it's okay to have concession stands in a critical habitat, of which you folks are getting money. This is absurdity. And so I bring this to your attention because it is a very contentious area. And I bring this to your attention, we've already talked about Kapa'akai, but what has not been brought to your attention is Napiai versus. And I implore you to take the time to really understand the significance of abandoning the state's fiduciary responsibilities for these five uplands. There are serious consequences. It's already been adjudicated in the federal courts. So I bring it to your attention now because I believe it has to be reads your kid and you folks lose, there could be trouble damages. And so there's a liability factor involved here. Where the University of Hawaii contends that it has to deal with this public and tourist type operation. Again, from my standpoint, this is absurd. You shouldn't even be up there. Religiously, you should not even be up there, period. Nobody should be up there. In the ancient days, that was reserved for priests and very high chiefs, period. And there were serious ramifications. As a matter of fact, there was only one ramification, and that was death, the breaking of the couple system. Now, I do realize that we're living in a different time period, and we're living under different circumstances, but it is still, you still must take in consideration what I'm bringing to your attention from the First Amendment side, as well as your fiduciary responsibilities under the Seat of the Lands Trust. Again, out of fair play, you cannot tell me that you have a right to shoot our game animals that we actually, in joint with the state, raised over Mauna Kea in the back of Mauna Kea State Park. And tell me that you can do that and take the game off the mountain, and at the same time tell me that it's okay to have halipuhaku at the mid-level, which is in the critical habitat of the Pulila bird. And so, and thirdly, for the power companies, the lease for the extension of the power, that of course coincides with the existence of the telescopes. And so, what I'm trying to express here is that it is ridiculous to think that you have to be on a fast track if you have 20 years already existing on the list, on the lease. And so, to say that we're going to go and we're going to rush this thing through within a month time, all your documentations and your consultations happened all within the last month. And so you have not given the public fair and adequate time to assess what you have been expressing or to be able to counter or even have public hearings. You have not even taken the time to bring up have a public hearing on the big item where all this is taking place. We've had to come down here. I'm on Social Security, but this is half my salary, half my income to come here. I don't expect you to feel sorry for me, you know, but it is reality. And so I do implore you to not take the fast track, take the time to do due diligence, because that will be reflected in a court. Again, I express that you should very much take a look at the Napeai versus Wilson case. Wilson, of course, was a chairman of the DLNR at the time. It was also under Ono and Patty. So there are severe ramifications for failure to take your responsibilities. And thank you very much for your time.
Kealoha. My name is Moanikeala Akaka. First of all, I think that there should be a declaration that this hearing is not in conformance with the rules. There's been no adequate publication of notice relating to this meeting, not to mention that these are conservation lands and it's within 20 days notice. The other night, I was at a hearing and a local over in Hilo and a local reporter had asked me what I thought. This is the first time I heard that there was going to be this this hearing today on the expansion of the lease. This was on Tuesday night. I hadn't seen anything in the newspaper about it, and not until Wednesday was there something. Was there an article in the Tribune Herald? So and not to mention that since it's conservation land, there should have been a hearing over on the Big Island. You know, it's like you're trying to pull a fast move on the people. Mauna Kea is, our sacred mountain, is on the Big Island of Hawaii, and yet the only hearing that we hear about is here. in on Oahu. You should definitely have a hearing on the Big Island. In fact, Teresa Donham, who's with one of the archaeologists from your division, had said that there should be more hearings, and there should be definitely be hearings on the Big Island, and also points out the significant damage culturally, environmentally, and otherwise that will be done to Mauna Kea as a result of this expansion. Fair market value, you know, is not a dollar a year. Our state is broke, yet the telescopes can make, in some instances, over $100,000 in one night for viewing. That's absurd. It's rent free, and we as individuals have to pay rent or a mortgage for our homes. But these foreign countries pay no rent. A dollar a year is really disgusting, and yet now they want to add 45 more years to the lease. We need an adequate environmental review, and there should be no exemptions relating to new construction. Mr. Strainey from the University of Hawaii has mentioned that university isn't proposing any new construction right now. You know, he's not saying tomorrow we may have new construction, but right now. You know, these so-called academics, and I have a great deal of respect for university, but you know, they think we're dumb. You know, it's right now we don't have any plans for expansion, but that doesn't mean they're not going to be doing it tomorrow. They also say, he also said that no other new uses of Mauna Kea beyond 2433 are foreseeable at this time. Are foreseeable at this time. You know, people think we're dumb. Are foreseeable at this time, but maybe 2 weeks from now it'll be a different situation. You know, to hear the university talking about acting as though they own the mountain. You know, bad enough, the DLNR for decades, and the court said this, were allowing the university to be negligent, to do harmful things to that mauna, our sacred mauna. And the DLNR sat back and allowed the university to make any kind, including polluting the area. But that was okay. You know, even hearing this woman talk now, you know, they talk as though they own that mountain. How the hell did you guys give them that mountain? That mountain belongs to our people. You know, it doesn't belong to the university, as much respect as I have for the university system. But you know, it's deplorable. You know, they have control of that mountain. DLNR has given it to them. DLNR allowed them to be negligent for decades. The courts have said that. But like, you know, DLNR goes ahead and rubber stamps everything the university wants to do. You know, that's not, there I mentioned earlier about a fiduciary responsibility that you board members have to our aina, to our ceded lands, left to us by our ancestors, lands that we have not given up title to. And regardless of what Mr. Ishibashi, who heads the union, you know, unions, they want more jobs, but they don't care about protecting the aina. You know, regardless of what he says about the whole island being sacred, well, Mauna Kea is especially sacred. And I don't see any of you public officials taking care of her. You know, it's a sad, sad situation. We need adequate environmental review, and there should be no exemptions. There should be no new... they say there will be no new construction, but as I pointed out, no new construction today, but tomorrow is another day. DLNR, as I stated, has a fiduciary responsibility to protect these ceded lands for we Native Hawaiians and the general public. DLNR does not have the responsibility to rubber stamp everything the university wants to do, as you have been doing. You know, this whole situation, as has been mentioned, is being rushed through. And, you know, it's not Pono. Somebody has to watch out for our aina, and that's your responsibility, DLNR. Instead, you just let the developers do whatever it is they make, any kind, whatever it is they want to do. You know, enough is enough. I'm not necessarily against astronomy or what they've done thus far, but enough is enough. And it's about time that they were held responsible, and it's about time that this lease, 20 more years we have, what's the rush? You know, I'm sick and tired of them feeling and acting as though they own our mountain and even these fake bodies that they set up. A lot of them are Shabai rubber stamp brigades. And, you know, we deserve better. The people of Hawaii deserve better. We Native Hawaiians deserve better. And our sacred Mauna deserves better. Mahalo.
Aloha, my name is Michael Kumukau. I'm a Papa Kealoha. I am in opposition to the lease. I would do a, for the record, a contested case hearing. Entered into Exhibit A is the City Council recognition as Papa Kealoha for the December 8, 2012. I put that in evidence. Also, the City Council of Honolulu, May 9, 2012, again, Papa Kealoha, a branch of the government, recognizing, fact-checking, corporate counsel, going through the whole position. Hanahome Magazine, Anthony Alto wrote it. He had to fact-check, Papa Kealoha here. They say that we don't exist, that's a lie. We do exist, and I'm here to say we're here, and we're claiming what the damage is, because nobody's put it in the box. Here, we're putting in the box for Exhibit A, the sacred sites at Lake Waiau that have been destroyed and consistently are being stepped on, not put aside ropes to keep them from these sacred sites. All these things, I would like your staff to Xerox them as cause of standing of imminent harm that is continuation. My TX copyrights on the limu that I was taught by my auntie, who was taught by Lilio Kalani from 1905 to 1911, Auntie Alice Volokai. My deposition of being a Papa Kealoha under penalty of perjury, outlining who my teachers were, sourcing them back. Newspaper articles in 2008 for the veracity of my statements and claims as a kahuna of limu in the, at that time, Star Bulletin. The sacred water places defined up at Mauna Kea. But as part of my testimony, nobody else was voideared in the sense of saying, no, you cannot do it your way. Every time I come up here, I run into all kinds of, I'm expressing it my way, uncle does, auntie does, but I'm not allowed to do it. Interesting, the only living Papa Kealoha that's not allowed to say cause of standing of continued imminent harm under these guys for years, and I'm making my case, but oh, let's not go that way. Interesting, my family is both lineal for Pu'upoleau and Pu'ulilinoi. Where did we come from? 13 BC, that Akua Noho Hoku family that is that possesses Wakea and Papa came through this hole, okay? This I want you to, this is the Po'ele'ele over Pu'uaveoveo on Mauna Loa. That's where they came from the Cygnus Nebula, which is the head of Haumea, which is in our stories, that's where her children came from. So I'm making the case, 13,000 years ago, the lineal receptacles of Kumulipo Chant 8, Chant 7, that we hold the body of our Hokuakua, are standing up, and I'm here in proxy for them, saying we are here, we've always been here. The fact that you guys broke protocol when they announced us to come out during the Hokulea stuff was all bad protocol, and my teachers were appalled at what happened there. So again, these are more maps and stuff of where the sacred sites of the entire mountain are. Because you guys asked for finding a fact under the Western lens, we come and we show it to you and oh, don't do it. We don't want you to talk about that stuff. Okay. The bottom line is, where is the finding of fact of cause of standing of imminent harm? Lake Waiau, the different limus that are there. Where does it come from? The four springs of Pu'upoliahu. At Lake Waiau, there's an entrance to Pu'upoliahu for our family, Iwikupuna. On the south side up on the mountain, there's another entrance buried by rocks to Pu'upoliahu. All of those pu'us are upside down water collection devices for the Pahoehoe lava tubes. They have Iwikupuna Ka'ai in there that are our family, that we are here to claim as what is right, that you ask cause of standing of imminent harm. We don't exist, I'm here, and I'm putting it all on the table, says, damn wrong, we're here. And the bottom line is where that continues. I'm trying to point it out specifically.
I want to ask you a specific question.
Yes.
To help us understand that. So, is any of the activity that DLNR has approved in the past, or the University of Hawaii has approved in the past, are you saying that we're directly responsible for Lake Waiau drying up?
Not the drying up, because the four springs are the permafrost.
What damage to Lake Waiau?
The damage is you allow everybody to go walking through to these sacred sites, which I identify where they're sacred. They should be roped off. You know, in Kona Village, where they had, when it used to be a Kona Village before the tidal wave, I'm trying to make a point, and I'm not off topic. They built a boardwalk like you do for the hot springs, so you don't damage the sites. Hello, that's the national park where they have all the hot springs. They build boardwalks so you don't damage the site. Same thing with Kona Village, the turtle, the honu petroglyphs.
So someone walking up to the edge of Lake Waiau,
yes.
Yes. That is damage?
Yes. Because you see here?
Can you tell me how that is
damage? Okay, sure. I'll tell you how. Let me get my glasses on. Okay, here, identify where the Ava offering sacrifices are at the edge of Lake Waiau. I show you where the Kua and Hina stone is on site FE26. I show you where the birthplaces are, where the Po realm is, where the memorial offering mound is, where we do it for the spirits of the dead. I put that out. The boundary stones for the sacrifice for the protection of the Ali'i sons. I put it where the rocks are constituting the Papakilo Kofu, dealing with Taurus, which is very important for us because that's Kiaka Huli Lani during the time of the Makihiki. So all of these sites that are little mounds of rocks that people walk all over are sacred sites for us. I put the hiding place for the ambush where the cave is for the soldiers, the place for the genealogical chants to be taken, the place to have the Ava drinking ceremony for the Aloha, the Lua warriors around the site. These are all sacred, not identified sites by cultural practitioner for generational knowledge. And I'm putting it down on the table saying it's in the box, you gotta consider it, it's on the table. And that's the cause of standing of imminent harm to answer your question specifically under rules of evidence and under, finding a fact. And I've had to become a freaking attorney. I'm in my own contested case with the Papipi, the Joseco Marina in the circuit court, not circuit court, but the Intermediate Court of Appeals. I've had to become an attorney, as well as the Papakilo Hoku. So I'm trying to give you the stuff you're asking for that has the veracity of finding a fact.
So you're saying that someone who is not a trained criminal standing next to one of the sites, if you say it's a
criminal, yes.
Is that...
Yes. Yes, because they're also walking and hitting the stones. When they step on the mounds and they crumple it up, they're doing cumulative damage. 45 years of cumulative damage of not roping this off and not identifying it.
That's what I need to understand.
Okay, done. Okay, and that's not all. We Papakilo Hokus use a Papakilo Hoku stone that's about this, it looks like a hockey puck. When you put it in my hand, that sucker is going to pulse. I put it in front of you, it'll pulse like your pulse. If it pulses fast, you're lying. If it pulses slow, you're not. I need that to do the Waihaka ceremony, the Lamapuli Olelo, the Mavaivai ceremony, the Kapu Kapu ceremony. What is in the box? I'm just putting it in. I'll put the chants, I'll put everything else you want in there. This has formerly been Kapu. But because if we don't put the stuff, the hidden treasures in, you claim we're all dead, it don't exist. I know 3,000 Hawaiian stars, 261 Hawaiian constellations, and all the stories. I can go 8 hours, 3 days in court to prove how Emerson, Emery, Maud McKemison, 1943, how this fits into the whole thing. This is our secret couple in the box stuff that we have to put out because under rules of evidence of the Western lens, you demand it. So we're getting it out. We're not dead. Despite what the Hokulea people keep on saying, I can prove them wrong. By the way, I have a student, a 20-year-old, and I'm putting all this stuff on him. In 4 years, I hope to uniki him.
You're not going to remember everything?
Yes, so you can Xerox all of this. This is all the thing in evidence.
It's going to take a while to Xerox.
Okay. Yeah, my poor brother gets beaten up because I'm the brown sheep of the family, and he works for DLNR, so please don't kick him very hard. But he is in DLNR and he gets beaten up a lot. But you can get back to me for this. These guys are dying. They're cursing me, so I got to get out of here. I know what it's like.
Okay. Somebody gets beaten up in DLNR. Okay. Hello,
Nancy.
Hello.
Hi.
Hello.
Hi. Hi. Chairman, Aila, members of the Board of Land and Natural Resources. My name is Jonathan Osorio. I'm a professor of Hawaiian Studies at the University of Hawaii, Manoa. I'm the president of Kahea, the Hawaiian Environmental Alliance. We are a 501c3 and have been testifying in opposition to the permitting of the construction for the 30-meter telescope on Mauna Kea. You have been given testimony regarding the religious and cultural significance of the mountain, and there has been considerable testimony about the violations to the approval process that has brought us up to this point. You are also aware of the overwhelming rejection of the proposal to approve a new long-term lease to the university by the associate students of the University of Hawaii, ASUH, which took place on the Mauna campus the night before last year. I don't think you need any more testimony about the approval process or the cultural significance, nor even really the environmental damage that, according to all of the environmental impact statements conducted on Mauna Kea, already caused by telescopes on the summit of the mountain. I believe these details have come to be seen by this board as relatively insignificant in the face of a multi-million dollar project, and the belief that the scientific potential of the telescopes outweighs even the damage that might be done to our environment or to a people's religious sensibilities. One example of this kind of thinking was the University of Hawaii Hilo's brief in response to our petition for a contested case hearing on the CDUP in January of this year. On page 9 of the UH Hilo brief, it argues that the resources of Mauna Kea, like trees for foresters, are its altitude and other physical characteristics which make it ideal for astronomy. But astronomy is not the only thing that defines the resources of Mauna Kea. It is a physical resource for everything that lives at the summit. It is a cultural resource for Kanaka Maoli as a sacred site, as a symbol of the presence of deities in the land, the sea, and the sky. It is an important historical record, not just of human activities on the mountain, but an immense geological record of this island, a record compromised by the loss of Lake Waiau since the telescopes were built. The mountain size and altitude affects weather and climate, precipitation especially. And to compromise that role, the role that the mountain plays, is especially foolish considering how little control we on these islands have over global climate change. We must know more about the effects of all of the telescopes on Mauna Kea before proceeding with any new construction. And this simply should not be pursued except after more careful examinations of how the ecology of the mountain has already been affected, coupled with a better understanding of how change in that ecology affects the lands below it. In fact, Kahea's opposition to the building of the TMT is not anti-science at all. We argue that astronomy is not the only science that has important reasons to think of Mauna Kea as a resource. It makes no sense to argue that environmental protections were skirted, because you already know that. You have taken the position, I believe, that the reasons for obstructing this project are not particularly important, and I would like to change your mind. The university's administration of this lease and the creation of this complex is dominated by cut corners, promises delayed, and a wholly insufficient evaluation of the damage that has been done by accretion of large-scale construction projects in a very sensitive environment. In truth, the damage done to the public trust by the Stevie Wonder debacle pales in comparison to this one. Extending this lease is a huge mistake for this agency, especially without a very careful auditing and evaluation of how the university has managed this resource thus far. I suggest that you deny a new lease to the university without a serious and thorough evaluation of its conduct of the lease thus far. The ASUH students have made some important points. Environmentalists, geologists, and native practitioners have more to say. Take your time. Rethink this. This is your responsibility, and right now, your responsibility alone. Thank you very much.
As the next speakers come up, I just intended a note that says that we can continue to take testimony after a news point. However, we cannot decide. So we can continue to take testimony if you like to move it.
So have you lost quorum? Have you lost quorum?
We have not lost quorum. Not yet.
Aloha mai kakou, aloha Mr. Chairman, distinguished board members, thank you for the time to speak with you. My name is Kawika Riley. I'm the Chief Advocate for the Office of Hawaiian Affairs, and we appreciate the opportunity to provide input and information regarding this critical decision before you concerning special and sacred lakes. I'll be brief, given the need for brevity. We have submitted our testimony in full and provided copies to each of the members. I can summarize with four main points, several of which have been echoed by others who've spoken. First, we are concerned that the proposed categorical exemption from environmental review requirements, we believe that they are not appropriate for a lease of this nature. We believe that they are not appropriate given, first, that the lease is necessary and related to plans for future contemplated telescopes. And even if it was not related to future plans for contemplated telescopes, we believe that expanding the current use for an additional 45 years would in and of itself be of such cumulative impact that it exceeds the threshold for a categorical exemption under environmental rule requirements. Secondly, OHA is concerned that the 65-year proposed lease may tie the hands of all the parties involved, DLNR, the state, Native Hawaiian cultural practitioners, from having the lands be put to the best possible use. It's impossible to predict what sort of changes may occur in 65 years. We're seeing great fluctuations and changes in terms of federal support, federal interest. We note some other sort of factors that argue that we don't know what the future holds, and this certainly ties our hands for quite some time. Third, we believe that if the board were to approve any lease, that lease should include conditions on future subleases that expressly ensure that meaningful compensation is received. Board Member Gon asked earlier about whether or not there were examples of what was paid for telescope time. We've included examples and referenced our sources. I believe it's on page 7 of our written testimony. We've found indications ranging from $80,000 to $100,000 for one day of telescope use. And lastly, we continue to believe that even if it is not required by law, an environmental site assessment would better inform all parties involved before making a decision about how this special, sacred, and sensitive place is utilized for the next 65 years. Thank you very much for your time, and I appreciate your thoughtful consideration of the heartfelt comments coming from all those involved. Thank you.
Aloha. My name is Pulama Long. I am an undergraduate in Hawaiian Studies at UH Manoa. J- just this past Wednesday, ASUH, who are student representatives of 14,000 undergraduate students on UH Manoa campus, passed a resolution to put a stop to this lease renewal of 65 years. So what this means is, or what this shows, is that there's an obvious opposition within our student body on campus, and that students need to be a part of the conversation, which if they still have 20 years, then we still have time to exchange dialogue about the situation. There's been plenty of discussion on campus and action that is in agreement to the evidence that UH has done mismanagement of environmental impacts and economic usage. For example, we're in the middle of a tuition hike while they're leasing the land for $1 a year. And cultural preservation. As a school that claims to be a Hawaiian place of learning, in their mission statement, the furthering of this lease to 65 years without addressing the destruction and desecration is unethical and unethical. Please think of the interest of the people, which is the students and the community. UH has 20 years left. There's no need for a rush. And it questions why there needs to be such a rush for extension.
Question?
Yes.
Did you come from Hilo to testify?
No.
Oh, you did not. No. So I was going to praise you for that. But
my family's from Hilo.
Yeah, my family's from Hilo. Thank you.
Just quick, because everybody said everything. But I, my name is Ilima Long. I'm a graduate student at the University of Hawaii at Manoa. I also just wanted to reiterate the increasing opposition to not only the lease renewal right now, but the telescope development in general at the UH campus. So as I'm sure people are aware, there have been two marches in the past couple of weeks that have been focused around the issue of Mauna Kea and the University of Hawaii's role in the desecration and in the telescope development of Mauna Kea. The University of Hawaii, in its strategic plan, does assert that it is a Hawaiian place of learning and upholds values of ʻohana, ahupua, and kuleana. And students on campus are starting to really come together and understand that it is up to us to define what that means. And many students are beginning to question the value of the telescopes on the mountain in comparison to what is at cost or what's at risk. The associated students of the University of Hawaii, the undergraduate student government, did pass a resolution on Wednesday, and I know that they've sent this to you folks. That was part of their resolution. Opposing the lease renewal, and I was at their testimony, and the concerns that were brought up, first of all, the ASUH representation is very diverse in terms of where they're from and what communities they associate with, and we saw a lot of different concerns coming from different ASUH senators, including the diminishing of biodiversity in Hawaii, and especially that which is specific to the summit of Mauna Kea. Questioning the idea that the university is nothing without astronomy research, and also being very concerned that there has been no time or space made for student input on the matter. And really, there's actually been no awareness at all that this lease renewal is taking place on the university campus, except for those few concerned students. And thank you to Kaleo covering up our mural. A lot more students became aware of the lease issue as well as the telescope issue. So the undergraduate student body does make up the majority of the student body at the University of Hawaii at Manoa, and they oppose the lease renewal. They also want there to be more dialogue and student-centered discussion before any lease renewal is considered, and want to be part of that conversation and in setting the terms if a lease renewal were to take place. I also just wanted to submit this petition. This is a copy of a petition that some law students, so there's undergraduate students, there's sort of random students putting together different things, and this is a petition that some law students put together opposing the lease renewal, and it received 1,000 signatures. It went live on Monday afternoon, and here we are on Friday, and it's over 1,000 signatures, so I wanted to submit that. These are from students, community. This is a community petition. So I think that it's just important in closing that we do consider that there is increasing awareness and concern about the impacts of the telescopes on top of the mountain, coming from environmental, ecological, academic, and cultural perspectives, as well as economic. And I would like to encourage you all to well, you can end the 20-year lease if you want, but specifically not to start a new 65-year lease. Thank you.
Very quickly, I'd like to reserve my right for the entry and to contest the lease. Thank you.
So we've officially lost quorum, which means that this board cannot make a decision on this matter today.
My name is Leon Noel Barroso, and I'm submitting this testimony on behalf of myself and my ohana to voice our opposition to the proposed lease at the summit of Mauna Kea at the University of Hawaii. I was born and raised in Hilo, Hawaii, and my ohana comes from Hamakua, and I am currently a PhD student in political science as well at the University of Hawaii at Manoa, where I dedicate my studies to the work that my ohana and I are involved in at home, caring for our aina and our kupuna in Hamakua on the slopes of our beloved Mauna Kea. Mauna Kea, as many of who have come today and who have come before us have told, is coupled, it's sacred. The genealogies that we O'iwi have been born from teach us this, and this is what we must continue to teach our children through our actions. Mauna Kea is the first to be touched by the rays of the morning sun, and the first to receive its waters that fall to us from the skies. And it, the Mauna, and all the Apua that constitute its living functions feed our aina and sustain us. This is not rhetoric. This is knowledge that is based on practice that sustain our people in these islands for generations. Over the past 45 years, however, the summit region of Mauna Kea has not been properly cared for, and the human activities on it have not been managed in a way that is culturally or environmentally sustainable. Under the state's own laws, these lands are to be protected as conservation lands, and as the DLNR, you are entrusted with the responsibility of ensuring these lands are afforded such protection. The current lease has facilitated the destruction of the summit landscape of Mauna Kea, transforming it from a balanced source of life to an industrial complex, poisoning our aina from its very source. This has occurred over the span of one generation, and the proposed new lease would facilitate the perpetuation of this transformation for generations to come. This is unacceptable. Our Mauna is calling us to envision a different future for its summit, a future free of development that impedes on our Mauna's space and ability to feed our aina and our people, and we urge you to act accordingly. We urge you to listen to the voice of the Mauna, to listen to the voice of our kupuna, to listen to the voice of those families who have dedicated their lives to caring for and protecting this sacred place. Listen to the voices of the thousands in our community who have signed these petitions against this process and against this proposed lease. And listen to the voices of the thousands of University of Hawaii students who are represented by ASUH who also oppose this lease. As the sacred waters of Waiau continue to drop to unprecedented low levels, the message has become ever more clear. The desecration of our sacred places mirrors the desecration of ourselves. Rescind this proposed lease and engage in the discussions and planning processes and actions necessary to ensure that our future relationships with Mauna Kea provide the Mauna, our aina, and the many generations yet to be born with life. No telescope, university, or dollar can provide this. Malama ya Mauna Kea. Mahalo.
Anyone else?
Simeona family, Kiawe family, Makikau family, Kikamanu family, the Kilikaliyo, the Simeona, the Sonora, it's all my family. My tutumen is the Kiole. I like talk about this place, the biggest storm there, like no one nothing to do with our land. This place that they call by all. Did you guys know what it means, why all? There's 9 hours per hour over here. I got a name on for you guys, so you guys know what you guys dealing with the mountain. It's all to do with the mountain and all to do with the water. You got Kaleikini. You got Honowaku. You got Ha'a'a. You got Ho'okano. You got Kawa. You got Hilea. And you got Waiao. And you got Ninole. And you got Punalugu. It's 9 hours. The water comes from all up there, from Mauna Kea and Mauna Loa. That's what feeds this whole place. And that's why it makes it so special and sacred. It's all our kuleana and our responsibility to take care of this thing for the next 1,000 more years. Whereas we're not going to get Waiao. We're not going to get all of these things anymore. Because everything's going to change. You folks have responsibility. You was talking about Waiao. I talk about Waiao because that's where the shrimp and everything come from, the Opa'ai. And that's what feeds the core. It not only feeds the core, it feeds the birds above and so is below. All the creatures that God, the living Nainapua, it's all involved in all of this. Whether it's the rat, the little, the mongoose, or whatever, that is all our part of our group, because that's what keeps this ecosystem moving and going. That's the balance. Now you guys cutting off everything, taking away this from the people. I get 3 children. My oldest is 21 years old. He get 3 years in college. I had to take him off the land to go. Not America, he's in Canada. My wife died 16 years ago. My daughter's birthday is next week on the 16th. They like come home. But where they gonna come home? No more all of this. Why bring them home when no more all of our culture? How come they talk all about this kind of culture? Whose culture are you guys talking about? It's all everybody here, not just the Kanaka, the Filipino, the Japanese, everybody that lives on this island. They are all Kanaka. They are all on this island. They're raised here. They get responsibility like all of us. Everybody that came here was just a guest. But now that you live here and you're part of the system, we believe in. We better take care of that for the next 3 generations. I thank you guys for giving me the opportunity because I got to go back to the big island. So God bless. Keep on doing the good work. Aloha.
Before you leave, are you interested in the contestant case for this?
Yes.
Just wanted to make sure before you leave. Yes.
For everything, okay? Okay. Guys, have a good day. What's your man now?
Aloha, Chair Aina, and honorable members of Board of Land and Natural Resources. My name is Jackie Hoover, and I have great respect for all of the testimony that has been given today. But I will say that I am here to give voice to my support and respectfully ask that you do approve the request from the University of Hawaii. As a native Hawaiian born, raised, and fortunate enough to continue to be living on Hawaii Island, my personal relationship with Mauna Kea goes far beyond living in its shadow and being blessed on most days with beautiful and dramatic views. Indeed, my sense of self, place, and spirituality are tied directly to Mauna Kea. I have previously spoken before this board in support of the comprehensive management plan, which in its implementation, I believe, does reflect well on the University of Hawaii, the Office of Mauna Kea Management, and the DLNR,
and the commitment to Mauna Kea. Recognizing that there have been mistakes made since initial implementation, there has been much progress made in managing resources and attempting to balance the needs and desires of many interests, many individuals seeking access to Mauna Kea. Your approval of the measures before you today will allow continuance of this commitment, progress, and the positive work that is being done, including to educate and provide opportunities to the public to participate in protecting and respecting Mauna Kea. Before closing, and in the interest of full disclosure and transparency, while I speak today as an individual with both lineal and cultural ties to Mauna Kea, I also have the privilege of serving concurrently as the Executive Director of the Hawaii Island Economic Development Board and as the President of Hawaii Leeward Planning Conference. I do not speak on their behalf today, however. Thank you for this opportunity.
I just want to address you this afternoon, very quickly. I know everybody's been here. My name is Kimmer Bighorse. I'm a 10-year Army combat veteran. I was stationed in Wahiwa and Scofield Barracks for 4 years. Been here, disabled American veteran. I just want you to let you know that I go to the mountain, I go to Kuli'o'o, I go to Mauna Kea to find peace. And this is, when I heard, I've been following the Aila no More movement, and I just want to say that I don't envy your position, okay? I know that your decisions, I know, you know, I protected colonels, combat task force commanders in Afghanistan and Iraq, and, you know, I know the pressure that must be on your shoulders to make decisions, this important decision. But I just want to say that through my experience, being a descendant of Gus Bighorse, my great-great-grandfather is a warrior for the Diné Nation, Navajo Nation, Arizona, that we also use mountains as our place of religious like worship. Now I fought over 39 months in a combat zone, Baghdad and Afghanistan. Come home to the Aina, come home to Hawaii. What is my home? And still see the desecration, and still see people's religious rights are violated, especially the native people here, the Hawaiians, the Kanaka Maoli. I just want to say that I support this movement. I support Mother Earth. I support the seventh generation. I come from the Iroquois, the Twin Towers. My ancestors helped build those Twin Towers. The Kawanakone. I've seen enough destruction. I've seen it. Eyewitness destruction. Life, the end of life. I'm tired of it. This is my testimony that this mountain is sacred. We must protect religious rights, especially with our own native people, the Hawaiian people. Okay, I'm not native Hawaiian, I'm not Kanaka Maoli. Okay, but I strongly know what they've gone through. The US government built power lines through my mother's land, through my grandmother's land, my Nali. And she did not get any electricity. She did not get running water. Her whole life. And we live in America. I just want to say this. It has nothing to do with ownership, nothing to do with that. Okay, I know there's legal this and that. Okay, I understand that. But if the eagle feather is a federal offense to possess an eagle feather for a non-native, how is an entire mountain not in any way an offense? Telescopes, okay, these sacred religious entities, these places where people go to worship, to give okay, then there's Pohakuloa where there's bombing. There's all sorts of issues. And we're just here, I'm here, to defend Mother Earth. That is all. Mahalo.
Aloha, Kaunaumi Kaleikini. I agree, I concur with all the testimonies that have been presented here today in regards to opposing the new lease to the University of Hawaii. And in addition, I'd like to say that myself and my family are state recognized descendants to Bibi Kupuna that we buried at Mauna Kea a couple months ago. And we are also NACA claimants to Mauna Kea. When we reburied the Ibi Kupuna, at first I was very disturbed how the university had tried to take control of the Ibi, tried to tell us when, how, and why to do it. We opposed adamantly, and in the end we were able to remember the Ibi ourselves. But it was not until we had to put up an argument as, you know, into why as cultural descendants, state-recognized cultural descendants, we should be allowed to take care of our Ibi. And so with that said, I don't trust that they will be good stewards of our Ibi Kupuna going forward. And I would insist that if there are any more ground disturbance in the area, that recognized cultural descendants be at the table for discussion going forward, that there should be an environmental assessment done, there should be a full, complete, not only archaeological monitoring program going on, but also cultural monitoring. We should have our people there to assist the AMs, and especially if you have recognized descendants, they should be the ones doing the cultural monitoring. Mahalo.
I strongly oppose the renewing of UH's lease of the land on Mauna Kea. For one, in my mind, UH has done enough with the telescopes installed at Mauna Kea presently. The renewing of this lease would not bring forth any educational purpose in my mind whatsoever. It would bring nothing but desecration, destruction, and annihilation to Hawaiian culture, our artifacts, and our Ibi Kupuna, which I would be completely disturbed by, but obviously that does not seem to matter. Because as an appeal, I feel that all land on Mauna Kea should be preserved at all costs to ensure that young Hawaiians like myself have a place to connect to our aina, to our kupuna, to have a place that is Hawaiian without the distractions of foreign objects upon the aina. I am Kaua Kili'inoe, my ohana and I are state-recognized cultural descendants, as well as NAIC proclaimants, and I strongly oppose to this. Mahalo.
My name is Candace Fujikane. I am an English professor at UH Mauna, and I'm also a board member of Kahea, the Hawaiian Environmental Alliance, which is a community-based network of over 12,000 kupuna educators, concerned citizens, many of whom are not Hawaiian like myself. but who work to protect the cultural and natural resources of Hawaii. I urge you, please do not renew the university's leases on Mauna Kea. The 1998 audit of the management of Mauna Kea and the Mauna Kea Science Reserve points to the ways that the university has failed monumentally in its responsibility to protect the conservation district of Mauna Kea. Moreover, the damage that the university, that done by the university, extends beyond the failure to protect the mountain. In the contested case hearing against the 30-meter telescope, what became clear is that the university is undermining and invalidating the entire environmental review process and the conservation district use process. So what has the university done in the years following the 1998 audit? Up until 2003 was the year that a federal court judge ordered NASA to conduct a full environmental impact statement. And the question is, why had those environmental impact statements not been required prior to 2003? Why was it mandated by a federal court judge? How can the university assess whether development proposals fulfill the 8 conservation district use criteria without the developer's full disclosure of environmental impact? When completed, NASA's environmental impact statement concluded that existing telescopes on Mauna Kea had substantial, adverse, and significant impact on the mountain's fragile environment. Since then, however, the university has been aggressively pursuing development of the 30-meter telescope, an 18-story observatory. So let's ask the question, who is providing legal representation for the 30-meter telescope? The University of Hawaii attorneys. How is that possible? If the university is responsible for evaluating any proposed telescope and ensuring that projects fulfill the conservation district use criteria, how is it also possible for the university to represent the 30-meter telescope? Second, UH attorneys have argued that since the existing telescopes have had a substantial and adverse impact on Mauna Kea, any further development doesn't matter because the threshold of impact has already been crossed. Now, when the university attorneys argue that future impact cannot matter, the university is invalidating the entire environmental impact review process and the conservation district use process. How can the university fulfill its responsibility to protect the conservation district when its own attorneys are invalidating the criteria used to protect it? The university cannot be allowed to continue this desecration of this sacred mountain. Aloha aina. Thank you.
I often come before this board either either as a warrior or as a peacemaker, and today I'd like to actually address a different kuleana that I have in addition to those, because because I feel that most of the points pertaining to the lease itself and most of those arguments were very well covered by the people who have testified before me. The specific kuleana that I have that's bringing me to speak today is that of health and the well-being of all people, which would include Kanaka Maoli and very specifically Kanaka Maoli warriors whose health are impacted by situations like this, by processes that they may be put into should you decide to renew this lease. I wanna kind of give you a little background of where that comes from, because I think you folks know me in other capacities, but I've been schooled by many people who are pretty crucial to health here. One is Dr. Kikuni Blaisdell, whom I worked with for well over 20 years, and I'm still in communication with. He was the one who encouraged me to get a master's degree in public health, and specifically to carry on the study of the health of Kanaka Maoli as it relates to the impacts of colonization. This I have been doing. I've been working with Papa'ololo Kahi for some time, specifically developing resources to help people understand health issues and what can be done positively, and also specifically studying many groups, and one of very important one being the health of warriors. And I want to say why I think that is very, very important in this situation. If you choose to pass this lease, you are saying to all of these people, everyone who has testified here, you are forcing them to go to war. And that is without question going to affect their health. Not only have, you know, the people who have the greatest kuleana to this, the people from Hawaii Island, have had to take money that may have been used toward their well-being and that of their families to buy plane tickets to come here. If you continue this process, their health will be further impacted by that. The stress is undoubtedly a very, very major impact. I would also like to acknowledge some other teachers that I've had. I've had three really great teachers as a warrior myself. One of them was Kamakahukilani Wanohofen, who was a native astronomer who studied on Mauna Kea. Kealoha and her sister Diane and I are all her students, and those practices we should be carrying on. And while she certainly was a warrior, that certainly wasn't all she was doing, but I have to say that our ability to do the other parts of the practices she taught us is impacted by the fact that every time this lady right here and I see each other, we're at war with this. And that makes us unable to continue those traditional cultural practices that we were passed on, that we were given as kuleana. I would also like to mention that Kamakahukilani, she was one of three mentors that I've had, and that Kealoha has been also part of. There were three students of Pilahi Paki. Their names are Kamakahukilani Vanohafen, Kawai Puna Prijin, and Puhi Pau. And those three are all my direct teachers. And I have kuleana to carry on their work, and thereby to carry on the work of the kupuna Pila'ipaki. I'm not able to do that if all that I can focus on is struggling to make this situation pono. That should be your responsibility. that should be your kuleana to do the right thing in the first place so that we do not have to go into battle. Another teacher that is very important in my health studies is that I have long been a student of La'aulapa'au. My teacher was Papa Henry Allen Awai, and Mauna Kea is a very, very important place where we were taught, and there are medicines that we cannot get from any other place than Mauna Kea. Those medicines would be very, very severely impacted if the university continues to hold the lease to Mauna Kea, and particularly if the development of telescopes on Mauna Kea continues. The waters of Mauna Kea, you've heard it many times, but they are beyond sacred. If you choose to renew this lease, you're choosing to have those desecrated. And you know that, and I know that, and we all know that. Because the University of Hawaii, thus far, has not been a good protector of those waters, or the la'au that grows on that mountain, or the mountain itself. The university has until 2033, so therefore, I have to say that this would be a very inappropriate time to make that determination. They, thus far, have not shown the capacity to be good stewards. By 2033, we may know otherwise, but at this time, we know that development has consistently taken precedent over the protection of that very, very sacred place. And yes, they've done some things that were good. You know, I'm not saying that they have never done those things, but what I'm talking about is the protection of the sacred itself. So I must say that in order for me to continue my traditional cultural practices and to pass them on, for example, to my daughter who's been outside during this entire hearing and still hasn't eaten lunch, in order not to impact her ability to carry those cultural practices forward, this lease must not be passed at this time. I ask that you not impact the health and well-being of these people who sit here. If you sign a lease with the University of Hawaii, their health will suffer. I ask, as someone who
for this reason. local government overthrew the Greek as the Hawaiian Kingdom. They have been taking a lot of land. Now, I believe it's illegal, but regardless, I heard today testimony that Mauna Kea was a sacred place for religious and cultural practices. I don't want any other culture that be attacked for their religion and cultural practices. What is it? Can you come over? And you know, maybe there are other cultures that are attacked, but I don't hear it. You know, we are Hawaiian, or the Kinakumami, they love so much. Because they like the land, they like the language, they like their identity through America. Another one there, you didn't want to kill America, an American education institution. Why? I mean, then Hawaiians are generous, they give. But just because they gave you the plans, doesn't mean we can think in the future. Because I know that the land, that the ancestors, that the culture, that the heritage, that's what brings them. That's what brings the Kinakumami unique and special. I'm looking into this school. I think the Hawaiians have talked about too much for America. You know, I don't care. This is wrong. The telescope of Moanikeala is wrong. They're taking away something very secret. Like going to the Vatican and pulling a telescope on the very cathedral. What makes Hawaii don't do this? I mean, then I don't think you may think you have the right. But I don't think so. They have given and given and given. Don't do this. Please, I mean, this is one thing that they secret. This is very interesting. Who they are. The very identity. What I hear. Don't do it. Please. This whole thing is a big mistake. It's a real mistake. You can use your own DNA anywhere else. has the right to abuse the horizon like this anymore. They've been abused enough. Thank you.
So good afternoon. Thank you for this opportunity to speak. I'm sure you guys had a long day listening to all the testimony, so we appreciate you guys still going on. My name is Moanikeala Akaka. I'm a first year graduate student at the Hawaiian Studies program at UH10. I didn't intend to speak today, but I just felt the call to place my voice on behalf of me and my family. I don't agree with the lease. I don't agree to extend it for another 45 years. I want you guys to consider the fact that the students of the ASUH put their voice in, over 1,000 people from the community have put their voice in less than a week. I want to encourage you guys to take your time with this decision. As we know, there's another 20 years left on the lease, and there's no rush to make this decision now. As you guys know, a lot of the decisions in our state, they're controversial. So I encourage you guys to please take your time with this and avoid another debacle skirting the environmental review process. The Lana Mauna Kea is conservation, so I think it's important that we remember that and stop the further desecration of Mauna Kea. I'm not paid to be here today. I'm just paid here and paid in love, love for land, love for culture, love for people. And I think it's important to take our time with this decision. The students, the university should be involved in this process. No students, no university. So we should listen to the voice of the university students, not those paid to represent it. I think that this is a big kuleana, so we should take our time. If it requires a contested case hearing, I think that's what it should be. We shouldn't rush through this process. The value of Mauna Kea, as we could tell from today's brief, very great, more than a dollar a year. I think you guys charge more for parking downstairs than a dollar a year. So something to consider. Thank you guys for your time. Mahalo.
For the record, it's bags that charges for parking. Did you come up because?
Oh no, I just need to make a quick. I just wanted to make sure. I heard Mr. Ishibashi bring up the lake issue, and I wanted to say that I am a lineal descendant to somebody there and around there. And I would strongly object to, I want you folks to, I want the process to be pono. I don't want the university having control over that. Because, you know, we don't come forward until we have to come forward just by the very nature of it.
Are you referring to the renewal of pipes?
I'm referring to, that's one of them, but I think the other Negro descendants have come forward and asked for a particular involvement in things like that. And I would want to be included in that as well. I just don't want, it's a very important thing. And it's, we also have modern and historic burial out there, right? So, and it includes other people that I will not mention here, but they're of modern importance as well, and it's their family too. So I just wanted to say, to add that in, please.
Okay. Do you know that if there conservation community for conservation, yeah. University, or a group that, cultural group that work with the university should contact you and think of the culture. The folks that you're meeting with.
Yes, and I want to put the emphasis back in your hands, being responsible, because I don't recognize the university's responsibility for anybody giving it. Okay? I mean, actually, we are responsible about it, but I just want to state that for the
mahalo for hearing testimony on this issue that is obviously so important to so many people. I'm here today, oh sorry, my name is Shelley Muneoka for the record. I'm here representing myself and my family. And I'm here to compel you, I apologize, I'm gonna have to read my testimony because I'm nervous. Most sincerely to vote no on the issuance of a new lease on Mauna Kea to the University of Hawaii. Over the last 40 years, the university has made many promises, but have come through on few. It would not be prudent or wise to issue them a new lease, especially not one that doesn't ask for any rent. If UH is saying that all future sublease negotiations will collect quote-unquote substantial rent, although Mr. Kopper from NHLC highlighted that the proposed lease does not require them to do that, we should ask who and what determines substantiality. We should also ask ourselves, why are they not using language consistent with Chapter 171 and saying that they will be asking for fair market rent? It further begs the question why UH itself should not also be charged substantial rent, whatever that means, although it's our contention that they should be also charged fair market rent. I wanted to say that it's painful for us to argue about finances when you're talking about a place that you consider so sacred, but I acknowledge that that standard of sacredness was shattered 40 years ago when development first began there, and now at this point we need to, you know, deal with the reality of the current situation. We shouldn't reward UH's poor management by giving them more time to do more harm to our sacred mountain. Both the 1998 and 2005 state audits found that UH is falling short on managing the cultural and natural resources of Mauna Kea. In fact, the 2005 audit specifically states how jurisdictional issues between UH and DLNR need to be cleared up, and failing to do so would likely result in a further harm to the Mauna. This is the opportunity to do that. UH has this tricky habit of claiming to be a state entity as a public university when it benefits them to be so, and a private entity when that designation suits them. They want all the autonomy without any of the accountability. It seems that DLNR has ceded the management authority to UH, but retains all of the liability and the ultimate responsibility for the protection of the cultural and natural resources on Mauna Kea. I don't understand how or why this is in the agency's interest. And this lease negotiation is a chance to end this problematic arrangement, or at least clarify that relationship and return management authority to DLNR, where, though not perfect, there are more clearly defined procedures and opportunities for the public to intervene. The primary developer should not and cannot be realistically expected to protect the culture and natural resources of a place it seeks to develop. On page 5 of the staff submittal for item D5, UH states that it is seeking a new 65-year lease to provide the basis for developing sublease agreements with current and any potential future telescope projects. There is no sign that development will slow on the Mauna, even after there have been admissions and independent findings of substantial adverse impacts that have already occurred. Page 15 of the submittal reminds us that the area will be subject to the 8 criteria that are applied to all proposed projects for any conservation district. UH and their subleases can't meet these criteria and don't currently meet these criteria. Their subdivision through subleases has indeed intensified the land use. Natural beauty and open space have not been enhanced or preserved. There has been public health issues as a result of the telescope projects, not only people because of the stress, but also there's a hydraulic spill, a fluid spill, there's been other mishaps that have happened. Yeah. And as was previously mentioned in my testimony, the TMT management plan, which is a project backed by UH as they're representing them throughout the contested case and appeal for the TMT, that management plan itself admits the impacts have been substantial and diverse. Why should UH be allowed to do further harm? Mauna Kea is sacred, and it's so shameful the damage that has already been done. And there are so many ways to strengthen protections for the Mauna. Prohibit new subleases, or put in provisions that say new projects must only be constructed within the existing telescope footprints. Or charge fair market rent. Or better yet, say no to any kind of lease extension at all. So many times we've heard that we can't change what's already happened, but today we have a chance to secure better protection for the mountain. And if the lease passes as is, we will look back at this day and remember that opportunity missed, that Kuleana neglected. Or conversely, if you vote not to grant the new lease, this day will be remembered as the day the tide turned, the day that the end to further desecration of Mauna Kea came back into view. Please vote to protect our sacred Mauna. UH has had 40 years to show Hawaii that they value our sacred mountain, as they repeatedly claim, and they have resoundingly failed to do so. It is naive to think that they'll be any different in the next 65 years. Mauna Kea is too important to roll the dice and cross our fingers that they'll be better. As Kealoha said nearly 15 years ago, the only thing the university should be asking for is forgiveness. Please vote no on the release. The last thing, I know that was a lot, that I wanted to say is that when we leave this building, we walk outside, I want everybody to look at the building immediately, diamond head of this one, which is about, I counted the floors, it's 15 stories tall. The proposed TMT is 18 stories tall, and I want us all to ask ourselves if that a building of that size belongs on Mauna Kea, because a new lease to UH, it will allow further desecration. So please vote no on the lease renewal, and again, mahalo for all your time and consideration.
My name is Barry Taniguchi. I'm from Hilo. And I want to just tell you that I really appreciate the opportunity for allowing me to share my thoughts with you. It really has been a privilege for myself to serve 12 years, the last five of which as chair of the Mauna Kea Management Board, and until recently turning out at the end of a 4-year term, 3-4-year term. You know, I fully support the University of Hawaii and Hilo's request for the issuance of a new 65-year master lease. Will there ever be a total accord on topics such as so complex as the sculptural, environmental, and scientific issues to coalesce at the summit of Mauna Kea? Unlikely. I don't think we'll have total accord. However, there are significant matters that need to be addressed through continuing dialogue and factual information. Criticisms repeated today, really old news. A lot of reference to 1998, the legislative bodies report. And those repeating those messages do so for it by design. We have come much too far to allow a group of people to spread fear and divisiveness with insinuation and falsehoods that disparage the efforts of many, many community-minded individuals. Fact, over 13 years ago, the 2000 Master Plan established a new form of community-based management of Mauna Kea, led by the Office of Mauna Kea Management, the Mauna Kea Management Board, and the Kauila Advisory Council based at the University of Hawaii and Hilo. This new management ensures community participation in the management and review of projects proposed to Mauna Kea. Fact. The follow-up legislative audit in 2005 raised some improvements made by the university under the master plan, especially noting the establishment of a Mauna Kea Ranger program and other factors. Granted, not everything was there, but we were on our way. But this fact, this happens to be ignored by those, a lot of the opposition members. Fact. The comprehensive management plan and the four sub-plans, the cultural resources, the natural resources, public access, and the decommissioning plans, were approved in the years 2009 and 2010, respectively, by the Board of Land and Natural Resources. After public meetings were held on Hawaii Island and vast community support, all of these plans are the state's plans, really, to manage the mountain. In fact, major milestones have been successfully achieved. Complete archaeological inventory survey was completed for 11,000 acres of the Mauna Kea Science Reserve. An accepted burial treatment plan has been developed. A successful ranger program has been developed. Natural resource stewardship programs, including surveys and studies on native and invasive flora and fauna. Community volunteer participation in invasive species weed pools and silver sword plantings are happening. OMKM staff members now include a cultural officer, a natural resources program officer, a program and project compliance officer, and 8 rangers. Astronomy employees and new workers on Mauna Kea now undergo cultural and natural resource orientation before being allowed to work the mountain. Fact, remember the once threatened Big Q bug? Research funded by the Office of Mauna Kea Management prompted the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service to remove the Big Q bug as a candidate that no longer needs federal protection. The University of Hawaii at Hilo and the Office of Mauna Kea Management are managing the resources of Mauna Kea with dedication and righteousness. UHH is achieving its commitments and has instilled spirited community trust through the excellent performance of the Office of Mauna Kea Management. Issuing this new 65-year lease will allow them to continue managing and doing what's right for Mauna Kea. Before I close, though, I'd like to clarify some of the points made. Just a few. There are a lot of points that are going to be good. Some of them, like for example, with Lake Waiau, a lot of responsibility and blame was placed on the University of Hawaii for Lake Waiau. I want to remind the board that Lake Waiau is really in the Natural Area Reserve, which is not part of the managed areas for UHH. It's not part of the UH managed areas. I think that's important, because we are not really charged with managing the natural areas. I know that a lot of people grumble about what we have done over the last 45 years. I would say, you know, probably 30, maybe 32 years prior to that, I think a lot was not done. But I think the last 13, we did a lot. You know, someone talked about the burial treatment they got, but don't forget there's a burial consult that we have to work with to get advice and help to handle ED. Someone mentioned about the medicine. But the medicine that they want to harvest from the mountain is not on the summit area. It's at the lower levels, we believe, lower elevation. So please don't confuse the issues of what we are responsible for and managing with other factors. The lease form, by the way, new lease form, allows us, the new master lease, allows us to go in and try to renegotiate the subleases to get fair market rent out of that, as compared to the old 1968 version of the state lease we are currently under. The proposed lease amendments had a lot of conditions which we insisted on, and we insisted that including the lease, so that people following us that are in charge will be bound by written documentation that we will follow certain things. And this is part of what we asking in the new lease, to put it in the lease. Don't guess anymore, we want to beef up the lease and carry it forward from now on. You know, the issue today is really the master lease. Everybody talked about the financial, the sublease and stuff. That's really not the issue. If we're able to get the new lease and we're able to renegotiate the subleases, they will come back to this board for approval of the sublease provisions if anything happens. And with that, I'd like to thank the board members for your time and giving me this opportunity to present a few comments. Thank you.
Anyone else on this side wishing to come to this?
Good evening, Dan Purcell. I'd like to comment just briefly on a procedure in this hearing. I know I received notice of this meeting late Friday evening, just prior to 6 p.m. And if you're on the Big Island and it's Friday evening and you receive notice of this and you're a parent or a worker or anyone else, to be able to put together travel plans to get here to Oahu and buy plane tickets and all that stuff to get here is quite a production. And I understand, you know, you're within the sunshine law in doing that, but as a practical matter, it really disenfranchises a lot of people who this is near and dear to them. The one gentleman spoke about his Social Security payments and that his ticket here was almost half of his Social Security payment, and that story can be told over and over and over again. So I've always been an advocate, since I've been coming to these meetings, of providing other locations on the Big Island and the other neighboring islands to be able to participate in these meetings through video conference. I understand there are challenges, the network goes down, you have to stop the meeting. I understand there are problems, but I think it's time to really pursue that, to give people an opportunity to participate. We all have to trust and believe in the system and our representative democracy, and you are those representatives, and we have to be able to trust and have the faith that you're doing the right thing, and that means having transparency and accessibility. I know I've addressed this room a number of times. I was told today that the capacity of this room is 50 individuals. Well, earlier today, we had 60 individuals in the room. I'm sure the fire department is going to come here and run everybody out, but the fact of the matter is we were over capacity, and we had people in the outside area who weren't able to fully participate in the meeting. They weren't able to see the presentations and the human interaction, which is very important. And as mentioned, though, one late speaker was here, her daughter was here, and wasn't able to even have lunch. I face the same challenges as I come to these meetings, but it's even more difficult when you come from off-island. You're traveling, you're trying to get here at the last minute, and you still have to try to get food. And there could have been some accommodation, possibly, to take a lunch break or something at some point to accommodate these people. So I appreciate all your efforts and all the work and time you've been into it. You're incredibly knowledgeable, especially the chair. But I think there's a lot we could do to improve participation in the Board of Land and Natural Resource meetings, including changes to the room. Thank you very much.
Okay, and with that, I will close public testimony. There will be no decision making because we don't have quorum.
Last quorum. So decision making will be another day.
Can I ask a question? So, when this is agendized for decision making in December, will you folks offer opportunity for public testimony again there, or is it closed completely?
Okay. Decision making in December.
Can I ask if the board members who were not here to hear the testimony, that they would be making the decision?
Yes, yes.
So
they would make the decision based upon what they heard, and they weren't here to hear this. They're welcome to ask us. We have the written testimony that was submitted afterwards. It's not a perfect system.
I'll send a link to the video.
There you go.
Okay.
So.
Mr. Chair, I have a technical question. So in the case of petitions being need to be filed for the contested case, is it 10 days from this meeting, or is it 10 days from December?
The final decision, right?
I don't want to give you advice, but I believe that it is 10 days following the
decision.